Booty shins!
Absinthe is the aphrodisiac of the self. The green fairy who lives in the absinthe wants your soul.
Come taste this lunacy.
is one in perfect harmony. It requires common sensibility to teach an intellectual capacity that I believe is in the air, but everywhere is the ultimate act of treason. So few could be aware that their nation's heart is bleeding. But oh, as a child who plays for fun, with his eye up to the barrel of a gun, watching fools.
Double shot. A pretty damn new Bad Religion. New to me. A couple weeks old. Something like that. On Wiedersehen's radio. Radio for your spiritual side. Twisted approach to the left-hand path. Good evening to all.
So that was the new Bad Religion.
That was new Bad Religion. Double shot.
Right on.
I got one other one. And as such, as we're in the millennial age, and we buy singles now off of iTunes... I couldn't tell you the name of the album. I hadn't thought of that. But, off their new album. And apparently they had one last year. I'm gonna check that out. There was a track or two that I saw that I liked off of that right away. Just what I was, saying to myself. So where's Bad Religion during all this? Think of the material. And they seized upon that. They have plenty to say. But there's so many fucking Bad Religion albums over the years. They just keep delivering. Thank you for coming to Wiedersehen's. The clown to the right of me is Marta.
Yay! Joker to the left.
Michael, Uncle Birch, that arrogant, rude asshole.
You have your moments.
I have my moments, but sometimes they're justified.
Overall, it's worthwhile.
Well, thank you, dear. Thank you. That's why you're to the right of me. Just within arm's reach. But I digressed already. Got a lot of things to talk about tonight. Chat room is happening. I'm going to say hi to you right away. I see Ron and Utu in the chat room, and I say hi to you because we're doing the broadcast on the mobile app, and I don't know. Maybe I'm paranoid, but a while back, I chatted back to somebody on the mobile app, and it just locked everything up, and I couldn't stop the broadcast. It was dead air. A grievous sin in my profession. No dead air. And I had to just like reboot the damn phone. So not ignoring you in the chat room and shouting out on the show to you. Hello, y'all. Now, before I even get into the stuff that I was going to talk about, you know, I was poking around looking for more stuff to talk about. And God, Brian Caine's book cover is all up in the Pagan News today. I have seen it shared all over the damn place in pagan sites today. And a lot of it, people talking shit. I think it's weird looking. I think he looks like a mummy. Now, I particularly thought that right away, you know, I know Brian Caine is, you know, he's a BTW, man. They're schooled in the old ways. And he has his palms crossed across his chest and his head up. Now, I thought he was doing the Osiris Risen, bless you, the Osiris Risen position of the old craft, ceremonial magic, definitely in gardenerian craft. That's what I thought he was depicting. The outfit he had, he had this white outfit, and I guess people were saying he looked like a mummy or something like that. People talking about his eyeliner. It's like, do you not know who he is? He and his husband are known for their eyeliner. It's just, you know, that ship sailed long ago. When I talk about the eyeliner, you don't know who these people are. And they have a whole philosophy behind the eyeliner. It goes all the way back to, I think, Laurie Cabot had similar philosophies about it. And that's tied into ancient Egypt.
Anybody I see who wears eyeliner, I automatically like that person.
Exactly. So I've been known to, you know, partake, you know, from my wife's sake. But magically, you know, I'm always thinking magically, and I do notice there is a certain enhancement to the second sight, to seeing into the other world. And that's exactly what I've heard Christian Day say. And when I was doing it, you know, I was a young, we didn't have goth yet. Horror punk, I don't even think they had horror punk yet. It was just spooky punk. I was a spooky punk and had eyeliner while I was doing my first witchcraft study. So they kind of just went hand in hand. So maybe I always had it on. So maybe I was just, you know, I was seeing into the other world all the time. But I do see an argument in that, and very much why it was used in Egyptian religion as well. The book hasn't even come out. We don't know anything about the book. Initiation, I want to say it right. Initiation into Witchcraft, I believe. Initiation into Witchcraft by Brian Caine. I think it's supposed to come out around Hexfest or somewhere thereabouts. The book hasn't even been published yet. But the cover is just created such controversy that I gotta love Christian Day. I listened to his show last night, and he was talking about it, and this is one of the things I love about the guy. Controversy doesn't fucking matter. He sees the dollar signs in that, the recognition that comes from that. It was B.T. Barnum that said to his early partner, Bailey, notoriety is all that matters, and every crowd has a silver lining. We should all hope to do so well. And, you know, they're out there laughing at Brian Kane's book. That's just more publicity out there. More power to them. I'm not going to argue with anybody out there. You know, keep floating the cover around. So there'll be a groundswell before the book even comes out. But from what I understand, you know, the attention on this book already is huge. The pre-sales will be quite large. So Brian Kane, again, you laugh it all the way to the bank. You laugh all you want, but he's laughing all the way to the bank. I'm sure, you know, his bank was fine, but he's bringing more to his bank based on all the people sharing it. Doesn't matter what they say good about you, what they say bad about you. And it brings me to a story right away before I even get to the subject matter. Phil Hine, the absolute best and easiest read on chaos magic that there is. There have been several times on my old pirate radio station, I would read Phil Hine with some cool like music down in the background. He just translated well to print and to speech. Phil Hine, once he had a big problem with gossip, a big problem with, you know, people starting false rumors about him, and he wanted to create a servitor to stop that. But then a little light bulb went off in Phil Hine's head, and he created the Go Who servitor. Now I want you to search that up later, kids. Go Google it. Phil Hine, H-I-N-E, Go Who, G-O-H-U, servitor. One of the most brilliant fucking things I've ever seen on the magical stage. Phil Hine's rationale: the power of a mage oft lies in the powers attributed to the mage from others. Be they true or be they false. Be they, you know, they conjures up demons and kisses their assholes. Does it matter? Be that you do great magical works and can conjure stuff up with beams of your light, or you're absolutely full of shit. Doesn't matter. And I learned this in many magical schools. It goes all the way back to Huna, where attention goes, energy flows. Keep talking about me. And I don't care what you say. I can turn that crowd into a silver lining too. And I would hope that every witch out there could. The grand old men of witchcraft, and many of the women back in my day, they were dramatic and controversial, and vast stories be told of them, and sexual proclivities, and all the way back, Gardner, Buckland, didn't fucking matter, all of them, definitely in the fairy tradition, Victor Anderson had it more than a lot, and some of those, you know, like the Frosts, well, the stories told about the Frost did not bring them the right kind of notoriety. So one place where that didn't work, but I guess that's just because they were the Frosts. But notoriety is all that mattered. And Phil Hine had this huge rationale. And so instead, he developed a servitor to create and stir gossip about himself out in the occult world. And then to bring those pieces of gossip back to his ear so he could sit there and have a laugh. And there was, you know, he owned a BDSM, a gay BDSM club in London. He kept several male slaves. He was a Satanist that engaged in blood sacrifice. I mean, it's just grand, dramatic tales that when you read those things, there's a lot of emotion that wells up in you. Terror, it's a power source too. The fact that when you read those terrifying things and you have this gut-wrenching reaction that wells up inside you and through your eyeballs when you're reading that, just adds to the power of the mage. True or false, just keep talking. Christian Day, he knows that. And he was his show Hex Offenders is on Monday nights, 7 Central. You find it on YouTube. I believe it's off of the Hex Education channel. And I watch it on Facebook. But there's different people chatting in YouTube. It seemed like there's more people chatting in YouTube than there were on the Facebook page that I was watching it. But I think he's transmitting that in several places at the same time. So I don't know. I'm just watching it on there. Now, that's one to keep an eye on or an ear on as we're talking about this kind of stuff tonight, because Christian Day is doing a whole bunch of stuff now. Brian Kane and Levi... Damn, I forgot his name. He keeps popping up in my People You May Know, just like Utu did way back in the day. Should probably know him. Rowling?
Yeah,
Rowling?
He used to show up at my feed, too. Who's this guy?
Who's the guy with
the
skulls? There we are.
Here we are.
Let's hold hands and sing Kumbaya, my lord. But at any rate, Levi, I want to say Rowling. I don't know. Somebody's probably in the chat room. Tell me how to fucking say it right now. Oh, God. Wow. Hello, Strix. Yeah, I don't see anything yet. But at any rate, Brian Kane, Coventry? Coventry. I think that show is called Coventry. I'm usually much more busy during that show. It's harder to... I usually see that later. But I think it's called Coventry. And he talks about, you know, from a British traditional witchcraft perspective and stuff. And they drink wine. They drink wine and they talk about witchcraft. What's not to like about that? But I believe, as I heard, there's a whole other thing forming around his new channel, online classes and such. I believe he's talking about like live on online classes, you know, group things and other stuff. I don't even know. But right away, before I even get into my list of the goods and the bads out there, that's one to keep an eye on. Keep an eye on Christian Day. He's got his public page. Maybe you can get on his private page. It seems not too private. But then witches and warlocks. And I always plug witches and warlocks because they let me plug my shit. They've been letting me plug my classes there for years and years and years. And somehow I got authorization to start plugging Wittershins there too. One of the first pages that we publish that isn't one of our own pages is Witches and Warlocks. Covendom. Okay, yes. I think that's what I said. Covendom was Brian Kane's show with Levi, whose last name escapes me. So they have a couple shows going on their channel. So, you know, those are definitely ones to subscribe to. There's different things to learn for different people. I remember when I first started listening to Hex Education, I developed an opinion about Mr. Christian Day. It's still my opinion to this day. The majority of the things that I love about the man are the things that his haters hate about him. The stuff that they bring up. The vicious way he ends a confrontation. I appreciate that. I first started listening to Christian Day's Hex Education back when he was in Salem. And, you know, Salem's like a witch city I can't even imagine. They've got all these witches in the same place. And whenever you have that, you're going to have faction fights and witch wars because our people have never really learned to get along or come together like the Christians or anybody else. We don't know the word solidarity. We turn on each other like vipers. It's sad, but it happens more often than not. And so I found myself at a smaller, a microcosm of that macrocosm in Santa Cruz, a burgeoning magical community that I helped to birth, that had gotten big enough for, you know, there to be, you know, elements that hated me and elements that liked me and, you know, witch wars and faction fights and all that kind of thing. And, you know, I hadn't really, where I grew up in my witchcraft, I always taught kind of outside of the main circle. I took on special kids, special needs and things, and taught from my house. But I was connected to and authorized by the main tradition, but I didn't teach in the shop much of my career at all. I taught at my home. So it's kind of outside of a lot of the politics and the faction fighting that went on within my own tradition, because as it got larger, the more of that happened. And as a community gets larger, the more of that happens. And I wish it wasn't the case, but it is. That's the real deal. It's a sad thing in my witchcraft life. It's become a good sign when there's faction fights, when there's trauma, when there's witch wars, that's a sign that our oppressor's far enough away for us to engage in that kind of shit. Because when the church really comes down, that's when we'll come together. But the fact that we have the freedom to fight amongst each other, unfortunately for me in my life, having seen that cycle go full circle several times and seeing where it ultimately ends up, it's become a good sign. Those kind of explosions that I see that happen in a magical community that's gotten too large tend to fling seeds further out and birth other magical communities. I now, even recently, you know, just right around the start of this show, I saw that same pattern happen, and it was just like the pattern I'd seen happen three times in my lifetime in my parent tradition. I saw that happen in this hoodoo community that we were involved in, and when we did the Tiger Gate shows and the endangered elephant in the room and all that. So I knew the cycle well. I had seen it. Yes, we're all different. Hoodoo's different than witchcraft, but it's a natural cycle that happens. And when that community got too big, that's when it turned in on itself. That's when it imploded and exploded. And when it exploded, it flung seeds out far and wide and birthed these other festivals, these other groups, these other shops that were not the Lucky Mojo Curio Company, that were not the Hoodoo Heritage Festival. They flung the... It took an explosion to fling these seeds far enough for them to take root. That's what happened to me as a kid. That's what happened a couple times in my tradition before I left there. And it was always a big build-up, big explosion, and every time when the group had gotten large enough for that to happen. It's necessary for us to, I think, explode and spread out so we don't get tangled in each other's roots. I don't know. There's some sort of natural cycle in there, but unfortunately for me in my lifetime, when I see that happen, that's a good sign. That means we don't have clear-cut oppressors enough to have solidarity yet and to come together. So I had not experienced that at the scale I was experiencing that when I was in Santa Cruz, and I had a lot to learn. And I hadn't been back to Long Beach to talk to Mom in decades. And I would listen to Christian Day. Christian Day was in a new witch war every week. And by next week, that one was done, and he was off to a new one. It was a constant learning experience on how to deal with some shit that I was dealing with on a much smaller scale. And there was new examples every week. And I always have said the same thing. I admire his finality and finesse in ending a conflict. He slits their fucking throat, and it's fucking with a velvet glove. He slits their throat and walks away with the most pleasant of smiles upon his face.
The thing is, he never starts it.
That's the other thing. He never starts it, and I never start it.
One common theme that I've noticed once I started, like, really understanding the psychology of aggression, is that it's always the aggressor who gets super offended and pretends to be the hurt victim.
Yes.
Always. It's the person who starts it.
Yes. And I've always said, if the offender doesn't get to dictate the terms of my response.
Yeah.
You know, if you've attacked, I will counterattack, and you don't get to decide how far I should have gone. I may decide that I need to end you completely. Yeah. Crush the enemy. If you seem like you're going to be that kind of persistent one, I don't want to give away too much of my workshop from Hexface, but if you seem like you're that kind of enemy that's going to keep coming back or going to be persistent or has a particularly deep axe to grind, sometimes I'd choose to just end the whole fucking thing. Crush the enemy and never have to deal with you again. So am I bad because you started it?
So you have the audacity to push back, and then it becomes this whole drama.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Who started it? Like, I wasn't going to mess with anybody, but if they started,
yeah,
I'll respond.
Attacker playing victim. No, yeah. No, never fucking works, man. Yeah. No. And it's always it's always the last refuge of those with no argument. They're going to do that. They're going to like start attack you, and then you're going to come back on social media, and then they're going to attack, you know, how harsh you were in your response, and they're going to call you rude and dismissive and, you know, shit like that. And it's like, you know, you don't get to do that. It's like, if you start it, and I may be a total asshole, you know, in response.
There's a, probably like a little bit of jealousy thrown in there too.
Oh yeah.
I'm a writer. Like,
yes.
I know how to tell a motherfucker off in writing. I do know how to do that. And they get offended. Well, they have no comeback.
Totally. Well, of course. You're a wordsmith. I've oft said that. If Martin decides to cut you a new one in print, it's going to be deep. It's going to go all the way through. It's going to be a through and through cut. It's nice, you know, surgical steel, man. Will not heal. But, you know, I've experienced that. I speak from experience. Strix agrees with Marta. What was I going to say about that? A thing that I've coined in the last couple days, dealing with, you know, some of the people on some of these sites out here on Facebook, rude has become the definition. Rude has become the definition of a person that has no argument, but they're pissed off that you disagree with them, or they disagree with you, but they have no argument, and so you're rude.
Or your argument's better.
Your argument's better. That makes you rude. And then again, the last bastion is to attack your tone. It's all going to be how you said it. Not what you said, how you said it. I'll play that shit. All right, so I jumped way ahead to Christian Day. He's, you know, definitely on my list, but I'll get into the list a little bit before we take a break. I was thinking, you know, back... Maybe I'll get into the list, but now the story that I was going to tell you before I went into all that other shit. When I was a younger man, teaching, like I told you a couple minutes ago, teaching from my house, there was a student of mine, and he really rubbed a lot of people the wrong way. John.
You rubbed me the wrong way.
That's why I gave you that look that they couldn't see. But he really had a way of just rubbing people the wrong way and saying the wrong thing most of the time. God rest his soul.
And I'm not easily offended.
Yeah.
But that was offensive.
But he was an early computer geek before there was an internet. And he'd always be talking about this shit in my class. He's like, you know, I was a geek. I was a ham radio geek. I was a shortwave radio geek. Entirely electronics, soldering iron, that kind of shit. Building radios, kind of geek. Different kind of geek. I don't know any fucking computer crap. I don't know any fucking computer crap. It seemed so unpagan to me, I guess. I don't know. living in Long Beach, trying to be all natural, I guess. But it just, I couldn't wrap my head around it. I didn't understand it. And part of the reason was because he didn't explain it well. He was grading. Love the guy, but he was grading. So he's talking to me. It's probably late 80s, early 90s, maybe the edge of the early 90s. I was talking about this thing. I've created this network. A network. I don't know what the fuck that is. And not listening to him. I'm trying to teach my class. Not paying attention to this kid. I created this network so pagans all over the world can communicate with each other. I still didn't listen. It made no sense to me. It did not register. Did not communicate. Maybe if we were on ham radios. A pagan ham radio club. That probably would have been a good idea, but I don't know how we would have set that up. Through the mail? That's all we had. I don't know how that would have happened. So he's talking about this thing all the time, and I won't listen. And he finally realizes, you know, picture's worth a thousand words. He walks into my class early one day, an hour early, carrying this big monstrous fucking screen with a keyboard attached to it. I later learned what is called a dumb terminal. Not quite a computer, but something that interacts with a modem and has enough memory to display text upon a screen. And modems at that time were dial-up, 1200 baud. Yeah, go Google how slow baud is. ancient technology. I had no idea what it was. And he fucking put this thing, he didn't ask me, he just set this thing up in a corner of my living room, hooked this thing up to my phone line, and turned it on, and typed in this thing, the Wonderland Pagan Information Network. And all these crude graphics pop up. It's all this pagan stuff. We had posts and categories for posts. We had email. These were called BBS systems. Kind of like the internet, but all the servers were private computers in people's homes. And at midnight, one computer would call another computer. And I think only one call happened each midnight. It was very slow. You could send an email across the coast. It'd take a week to get there. Snail mail was faster. But it was the same basic premise. You know, it had an at. Stuff was... I don't think we had WWWs yet, but at was part of the email process. So we had these groups. And so, like, you'd post something, and at midnight, the computer would exchange data. So sometimes you wouldn't get a response to your post for several days, maybe a week. Some of these things linked up into, there was a couple legs into England and Ireland. But my student and others had created this network through what would become the internet so pagans all over the world could communicate. And I didn't listen. That's the real fucking crux of the story. I needed to have it shoved down my fucking throat. Now look at this shit. All of this shit is based on... There's on Facebook, there's a pagan information network. They have no idea of the history behind their name. The PIN was the network. My friends was the Wonderland Pagan Information Network. There was a Celtic one over in Ireland. They hopped around. These pagans were able to communicate. Now, I don't want to give away the whole story. You can go to YouTube, watch my video called The Statement of Intent for the rest of that story. It's fascinating, especially now when we're all trying to cast mass spells. Well, not all of us. When a lot of us are trying to cast mass spells on Trump and shit. Well, some of your ancestors back in the very early 90s did a similar thing. We are Wittershins, and we're going to take us a musical and whatever else break we have to do. Let's find a cool enough song. Oh, yes. This is always good. Wittershins. We'll be right back.
From the cradle bars comes a beckoning voice that sends you spinning. You have no choice.
You hear life.
Susie and the Banshees. Winter Shins. Now, y'all need to follow the show, right? I'm not going to give you the whole speech about our big package and everything, but you follow the show. Whether you're on iHeartRadio or Tumblr or YouTube or on Spreaker itself or any of the other fucking places that I can't even remember where we're broadcasting. I have to go through my email. They all send me junk mail. We're all over the damn place. And wherever you are, there should be a follow or a subscribe button. You never know. We may just go on the air. Hey, we could, while we're at Hexfest this summer, pop out my phone in between, you know, my workshops and panels and shit, and just do a Wittershins from somewhere in New Orleans. Probably won't. We could. We could just be all drunk and do a show. Not like we haven't done it before.
I don't think we're going to be there on a Tuesday, though. We're going from, like, Thursday to Monday or something. What?
You are so cute.
What?
I'm talking about the fact that we can go on the air whenever we want because of our big package.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. But when are we going to have time for that?
I know. Well, that's what I said.
I don't want to be, like, totally working the whole time.
Well, that's what I said. You know, we probably won't.
Yeah, we probably won't.
It's not like this is work.
Well,
we're not breaking a sweat over here.
I would rather be, like, speaking to people that we meet over there and not doing a show.
Yeah, I suppose so. Hello in the chat room. Seeing Strix, Lisa, all their usual cast of characters. Utu's in there still. Ron, hello. A bunch of people scrolling around. So, yeah, there's so many places. For the longest time, it was like Witchvox. Witchvox was the thing. I don't know so much anymore. I probably won't plug a whole lot of like web pages. That's just not how I get this kind of information anymore. Maybe it's me. I don't know. More social media, you know, stuff pops up in my feed, and that's how it catches my attention. But back in the day, Witchvox with a V, you know, they used to have a news service. I used to do a pagan news show on my pirate radio station back in the day, and that's the only place I could get any pagan news, and I did. But they had like these. You know, they have posts and stuff, which is all really, really cool stuff. They had, like, these search engines. Like, you could search for a shop, a group, coven, ritual. You know, they had all these parameters you could set to different areas and stuff. Like, that seemed like really handy stuff back in the day. But I don't know how popular that is, how many people are using that format. You know, if it's not just continually feeding through their phones, I don't know if the millennial witches ever see web pages or type in www. I don't even think they have to do that anymore. There's so much out there. Now, I've been teaching on YouTube for close to 10 years. Because some young student of mine suggested that I should do it. It was such a crazy idea. And I said, no, you can't do that. You can't do that. That's against the rules. It's against the tradition. I felt so old that I started making videos. That has spurred into correspondence courses, video download courses. I'm all over fucking video. Fucking Ask Uncle Birch. I'm going live all the fucking time here and there. That's a good idea. There are many out there now doing it. And I subscribe to many. If you go to my page, FreakPhil1309, I made mine not that easy to find. I didn't call it, you know, Witchcraft 101 or anything like that. I didn't want it to be that easy to find. And knocking on wood, I have a lack of trolls. There's only about a handful of people I ever had to just, like, ban from my... from my YouTube page, knocking on wood again. Maybe that's why. It's not that easy to find. FreakPhil1309. If you look at the people I subscribe to, I don't subscribe to anybody all willy-nilly. There are a few things out there not witchcraft related. I like to watch all kinds of weird like military videos of those planes up in the sky shooting people from miles away. Shit like that. Subliminal programming videos, all kinds of stuff I like, but the people that I subscribe to there, too long a list to include here, but if I subscribed to them, there was a reason. And I may not always watch them. I don't really watch that much video on witchcraft. I listen to stuff while I'm doing other things, but my eyes are kind of busy a lot of the time. But I do, from time to time, I'll put a computer on autoplay on my subscription list and just give all the people that I subscribe to free hits. Even Russia TV is getting hits from me when I press autoplay. I doubt they know this. But there are some out there. Patty Negri, we had her on our show.
Negri,
I'm still saying it wrong. Patty Negri, had her on our show. She's got a YouTube channel, a lot of subscribers.
She is busy.
Yeah, I mean, she's all over the place.
Very busy. Every time I hear from her, she's like in another state or another city or doing a new, somebody's special guest on a podcast. Like,
I think she has started her own podcast.
Like,
I saw something like
seriously,
that.
Seriously, almost every single night, that woman is busy.
On a red carpet somewhere and shit.
Yeah.
Wrap around the neighborhood. Hello, Two Moons.
Pat, I mentioned her in my blog.
Two Moons, she mentioned you in her blog. It's coming out probably tonight. Lair of the Dog, as we mentioned last week.
This one is called Lair of the Cat.
Yes. But it's at lairofthedog.com.
Yeah.
Right. See, Marta here, she's a writer. And writers need to write. And we have this big-ass, beautiful, big-ass dog that has severe... is a rescue dog. He has severe separation anxiety for good reason. He was quite likely abandoned during the California wildfires a couple years ago. Back when, one of the first times when entire neighborhoods were wiped off the map. Which has happened every year since here in California. So I feel him. I understand why be concerned when his humans leave him home. Because maybe home wasn't safe in his last home. Maybe he got abandoned in his last home and had to face fire and shit. I don't know.
And it's funny because when you can leave the house.
Yeah.
And he's fine. As long as... one of the three of us is there, or strangers, like we leave him with a sitter, we leave. Like, we're totally gone, and he just needs a human being there at all times.
Yeah.
That's all.
So,
it doesn't have to be us.
He can't be left home alone, or he'll eat through the door.
Ever.
I mean, literally. He's eating through the fucking door.
When we go down to the pool, we have to take him with us and tie him to the fence.
Yeah. And, Los Angeles and, definitely the Hollywood area is extremely dog friendly. And so we've had to learn to take him pretty much everywhere with us. And as such, we've learned a lot of the dog friendly places around town. And now Marta's writing about it. And people love that kind of shit. And they want to take their dogs there too. And thing really took off. So, lairofthedog.com. There have been times when Marta's not talking much on the show and she's over here typing. There was a time she was over here typing up her blog while on the air. You were missing the magic if you weren't over there at lairofthedog.com. We rescued a Siamese cat. Well, yeah, and Lisa's talking about her cat. This actual next episode is Lair of the Cat. It's how our cat has dealt with the dogs. Back when we were dog sitters,
but it's about the cat.
The opening premise.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's about the cat. Lair of the Cat at lairofthedog.com. So Patty Negri, I watched several of her videos. They're really, really good if you've got like a noob that's easily scared or shocked. That kind of thing. She's just like really easy, easygoing. She's always smiling. Always talking about the good side of things. So it's like, those those, you know, mild of heart witches, you know, that's an excellent one. But as I stated when she was on our show and I was flipping through her book, you know, the magics that I stumbled upon while doing my on-air bibliomancy in her book, there's some old school shit. And right away, fell on a spell or two that I had done, or I'd known somebody that had done. You know, it's the real deal. Just everybody got their own way of delivering the message. I've been arguing with some people on some noob sites recently. I'm saying, I'm sorry, you don't get to judge my teaching skills. You know nothing of my work. It's a psychological subliminal thing at times. It's demonstrating a symbolic thing at times. It's sometimes fucking with your head. It's sometimes agitating you, pissing you off. These are just some of the artistry of teaching. And there are times to do that. There's my mom. I look at some of these noobs on some of these sites that I'm going to talk about. It's like if my mom had to deal with them, they would die. They would have turned into a pillar of salt in front of her, because mom always explained things in the most drastic, dark, scary way you ever heard. Like, she'd say, when you're done with the circle, never leave the elementals just lying around, or they will decay to their most negative and vile form and cause havoc with your lives. Have you thought about that? Decaying, havoc-filled earth spirits, air spirits, water spirits, fire spirits in the fucking house? Yeah. You never made that mistake because of the way mom demonstrated that. Mom taught me how to protect myself by teaching how a evil magician hexes people. She would paint this picture of this dark witch skulking around under the dark of night at 3 a.m, having collected your hair and your fingernails, attacking you in your sleep, and then waiting for you to fall back asleep, and then attacking you again, and then attacking you again, driving you slowly insane until nobody could save you. That's how Mom opened up protection magic. I never forgot fucking word she said after that. It was drastic. It was scary. It was horror-filled. You know, Hollywood has a reason for their techniques, for their magics. They drive something home that sticks in the mind. And some teachers have that. There's a stage presence to it. There's Marta always likes to get on me when I'm on the radio. I'm doing these hand gestures that you can't see. There's hand gestures. There's glamours. These kind of things. But there's horror, intrigue, fear. These things drive a lesson home. Witchcraft has never been for the timid in any version I've ever known. Many spiritualities out there. You go New Age. New Age. Looks like New Age, but it's one word. It rhymes with sewage. Plenty of ways for the timid to approach spirituality there. That's not here. And should have never been in Wicca either, because Wicca didn't come from those stocks. Wicca came from Gardnerian stocks and the BTWs, and they definitely didn't have no namby-pamby fluffy-ass version of the witchcraft. Its darkness was intact. You know, they brought up that witch's reed down the road and that kind of stuff. But still, it was not for the timid. It was always at night. And you're always burning things. That's not for the timid. Sometimes pyrotechnics and stuff. You know, spirits show up. Demons show up. Things go bump in the night. The true measure of a witch is their reaction when something actually goes bump in the night. Their reaction when weird shit actually happens. You know. Then you know who the true witch in the room is, because they're still in the room. The the ones that weren't witches, they ran away. Anyway, there are so many out there on YouTube. I'm not going to be able to mention all the YouTube ones. I, of course, you know, I have my favorites. I've been liking Beyond the Veil. There tends to be a podcast. I haven't seen any with actual video of the ones that I've watched, but Beyond the Veil, they tend to, you know, get into the hermetic side of magic, borderline ceremonial kind of thing. And I always like that. I like to, you know, take magic back to its roots and then fuck with it, rather than fucking with it after it's been watered down a couple thousand years. So I like to start with older things like hermetics. The place where I grew up still just says Hermetic Supplies on the window. It's one of the oldest witch shops in the country. That's all it says, Hermetic Supplies. And it manages to float still. Now, the Ancestral Witch, she caught my attention. I'd known her for a while, but then she caught my attention because she became controversial because she's one of those white people to have crossed over as myself. She's a Yaya. She's a Palera. And as such, some of the more bigoted Paleras and Paleros attacked her pretty much just for her whiteness. I watched the videos that they were talking about back at the time. All seemed very valid shit. She wasn't out there teaching Paulo on the internet like some people are. I saw nothing wrong with her content. I always liked her. And, you know, right away the first thing I liked about her was attitude. There's a certain amount of skills you need to present in audio and another set in video. And they can cross over. I got them both. There's a charisma, there's an attitude, there's a way that you shoot your videos that makes them more intriguing. And if you got it, you know it. And if you don't, nobody can teach it to you. And I always saw that. You know, she had this certain edgy attitude that I liked. Very Southern. I like that. Thorn Mooney. I like that one. You know, all kinds of different, you know, lessons in magic, Wicca, that kind of stuff. I always got a shout out to Magic TV. Because by my reckoning, Magic TV is one of the first to go there. And I think they may outdate me, and there's not a whole lot on YouTube that outdate me in that endeavor, that are still going at least. And I'm not even sure how much new content Magic TV has. But, you know, I got to always give a shout out, 'cause, you know, that they were some of the first, and, you know, they're from the tradition that has that is using my last name. They are from the Karelian tradition. And the main members' last names are Karel. And I don't really know if there's much of a family connection there, but right away, when I always remember when I first looked them up and said, who the fuck are these people? I noticed a healthy dose of Strega in what they were teaching at the Karelian nativist tradition. I haven't seen that word. I'm not even sure if they're still calling it that, but that's what they were calling it back in the day. But they're up there. The other Karels on the other coast, they're out there teaching. They had started a whole school. I remember a brick and mortar. I mean, they did a thing. People like adopted bricks or donated bricks. Like, people would pay out in the magical community for the bricks that would make this building that was going to be their magic school, which I'm pretty sure they accomplished a long time ago. But they started, did a whole lot of video content. There was a pagan news show that they were starting out of there. I never saw a whole lot of traffic from that. I saw a few videos, and they definitely didn't come across my feed after that. So maybe they didn't, you know, maybe like Wittershins, you know, they don't find a whole lot of pagan news out there sometimes. So, you know, you got to have somewhere else to go. Have something else to talk about. Anybody you watch on YouTube, Clown to the Right of Me, anymore? Like magic wise?
No.
I mean, because everybody's got a how-to. I guess if you just how-to the spell you want to do, you're going to come up with somebody. And, you know, yeah, if you got any of the... let's see, Two Moons Love the Ancestral Witch. In the chat room, if you've got other people that I'm not mentioning, go ahead and throw them in the chat room. I will mention them. Tata Oriate. Now, while Ancestral Witch is Polera, I haven't watched all of her videos, but I did not see her teaching really in Impala. Tata Oriate, we'll go there. To a certain extent, you know, there's only, you know, an inch tradition, even with his high rank, there's only so much he can say, there's only so much he can do, but he goes there. He's one of the few that I know in Palo to write a book. You're not supposed to go there either, but he has, and I found it a very informative book as a Polero. And I'm waiting for the next one to come out. And we had him on the air recently, so check the archives. It was a really good show. Let's see in the chat room, anybody? Two Moons putting a link. Oh, Madam Nadia. Oh, is that the Madam Nadia? Like, that Madam Nadia? Yeah, it's probably. Yeah, I didn't even know she had a YouTube channel. I see her go Facebook Live sometimes, but I didn't know she had a YouTube channel. But in the chat room, if you went and followed us and signed up and stuff like that, you could just click the link that Two Moons just put up, and you go to that page. But I'm not going to make it easy for you if you're not following the show. God. To Tata Oriate, this other guy, Tata Butako. Tata Butako, he gives away a great deal, mostly Pati Pembas, and how to work with Pati Pembas. The language behind the Pati Pembas, extremely complicated, it's a language, and how to burn a lot of fula, gunpowder, on Pati Pembas, which are very entertaining to watch. And it's, you know, he always has this, you know, he has a whole Manonso set up, and, you know, he's on the floor and the pavement.
I miss burning fula.
Yeah, we definitely can't burn fula up here. Maybe we got like a terracotta plate. We need to burn fula on a terracotta plate or something. Not on the ground like we used to. That was fun. Make all kinds of cool shapes and stuff.
All our garages had the right fula.
Ah, man. All right. That's just TMI for you people. And then again, Hex Education has their YouTube channel, and Hex Offenders is on there now too, and Brian's show's on there. So there's a lot. There's a lot out there. There's a lot more. There's a lot more that I will tell you when it's time to tell you. It is not yet time to tell you. It's Wittership.
Long ago in a dusty village full of hunger, pain, and strife, a man came forth with a vision of truth and the way to a better. Compelled people to follow along, but the hunger never vanished, and the man was banished, and the village dried up and died. At a time when wise men peered through glass tubes towards the sky, the heavens changed in predictable ways, and one man was able to find that he had thought he found the answer. Was quick to write his revelation, but as they were scrutinized in his colleagues' eyes, he soon became a mockery. Don't tell me about the answer, 'cause then another one will come along soon. I don't believe you have the answer. I've got ideas too, but if you got enough naivety and you got conviction, then the for you.
for charity. Everyone begging for an answer without regard to validity. The searching never ends, it goes on and on and on for eternity.
In the chat room, we got a whole bunch of data. Let's see here. We got Desperate House Witches. I've heard of that one. I've been meaning to check that one out. But now that Strix mentioned it, I'll check it out. Down at the Crossroads. New World Witchery. All podcasts on iTunes. Now, I really haven't gone through the trouble of uploading my shit to iTunes. It's like every place else, they just like, it automates. I can put it on iHeartRadio. They put the archives up there. Everything. Just fucking up there. Everybody else, iTunes, I got to upload it. So maybe I'll get around to doing that one of these times. All right. So those are some good ones. Candelo's Corner on Blog Suck. Oh, wow. So.
Blog Suck?
Yeah. Remember Blog Suck Radio?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, they still have our archives? Am I on those? I'm on some of those, I bet. I gotta be. Oh yeah, featuring Michael Corella's co-host. Yes. Yeah, it was always really weird when we had Candelo on this show, and you know I was the host. I didn't know what to do, but we couldn't hear him that well too. It was weird. We were still figuring. It was early on. We're still figuring stuff out. We'll definitely have Candelo on again. But yeah, Candelo's on Spreaker now, right here. Just look up Candelo Cambisa. I think he had a couple Candelo's Corner show. I think it's still called Candelo's Corner Radio, but it's 12 o'clock somewhere. He's on almost every day or at least several days a week, in the afternoon for about an hour. Sometimes guests, sometimes just Candelo ranting. For us, it's like closer to like 9 in the morning or something like that. So it's more something to like do with coffee, listen to Candelo. But those are some good ones that I'll have to hopefully remember to check out. Especially the Desperate House Witches, I've heard. The Witches with Wine, I've heard of that. Keep It Magic was interesting. The archives are on Blog Talk. Okay, Keep It Magic. All right, that was interesting. And then, yeah, what was it? All right, they're still talking in the chat room. More of them. Okay. All right, so those are... I hadn't even gone to podcast because I was just writing down these things and it took up so much of the paper already. The podcast, yeah, you know, Devin Hunter, we just had him on there. The Modern Witch podcast. There's a lot of good podcasts. Probably have to do a whole show just on podcasts, I guess. Then there's audiobooks too. There's some decent occult audiobooks out there these days too. So many ways.
So much stuff at our disposal. That,
yes.
You know, we didn't have, like, even, well, 10, well, for sure 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Probably not even 10 years ago.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
And me,
You can learn anything you want.
Anything.
About anything you want.
I know.
For free.
I've been, like, under anything. A sink and learned how to fix what I was under the sink to fix watching a video. All the time. If you learn how to search for it, you'll find something.
You know, it's like the Matrix when you just like have the program and you stick it in your brain.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we're getting there. Mm-hmm. We're getting there.
Right now, we're still taking the longer roundabout way. Yeah. We're getting there.
Yeah. Well, so I've been on this teaching frenzy. I I stopped doing my year and a day long correspondence courses for like close to 2 years, preferring to do this just the downloadable courses. And I flung myself into doing that. I ended up with a packed class and had to start another class. That's pretty packed too. And I started practicing and you know, just refreshing myself, getting my muscles ready. It's like, you know, there's new questions all the time. There's new kids all the time. They're thinking different things. Then I thought, when I was a new witch, I need to, you know, stay abreast of the common questions out there and the stupid fuckery out there, the bullshit that other people are spewing out there. So I delved very deeply into noob witch sites. I got on several. And I'll answer things as Uncle Birch. I'll butt heads with some admins and some other people there. And, you know, sometimes we'll get past it. And most times we get past it. You know, eventually, you know, people realize, you know, I may be, especially in print, I'll be arrogant as fuck sometimes. Huge chip on my shoulder. But I earned that chip. If you can knock that chip off, more power to you. But I earned my chip on my shoulder. It don't come across sometimes. And usually when somebody gives me shit, you know, usually I'll give some advice. And somebody that's, you know, a week into Wicca will argue with me. And then I'll become a bit more curt in my response. And towards the end, perhaps downright harsh, maybe rude, because I will disagree with them very vehemently, and that really upsets a lot of noob witches when you disagree with them and they don't really have an argument. And then they'll start playing emotions on you and say, "Oh, you're harsh, you're rude, you're dismissive," rather than actually speaking about the content of what you said. And there was one I remember. Matter of fact, we were sitting, you know, I think we were having coffee one morning, and Marta saw one of the stupidest questions anybody ever asked in any noob site ever, and it was so stupid I can't even remember what it was. Even though I don't believe there's any stupid questions, this might have been the one. But it was on this noob site, and I had to become a member of that noob site just to respond to that. I just felt compelled. And it was called Practitioners of Witchcraft, was it?
The name of the page?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Practitioners.
Maybe.
Practitioners of Witchcraft, I think it was.
Okay.
Well, anyway, I get kicked off of that page because early in the week, last week, some noob said that, you know, she burned a candle for a reverse love spell, and the wax burned down before the wick burned down. What, you know, mystical meaning does this hold? And people are answering all this crazy stuff all over the place. And I'm like standing there in the middle of this thread going, am I the only one that sees that the emperor has no fucking clothes? And thousands and thousands and thousands of candles have I burned and made. And unless I really fucked up making the candle, the wick should burn down last. Quite often, there's just a little piece of wick sitting there in a pool of wax. That's optimal. That's optimal. I have less drippings to deal with. But I felt like it was fucking crazy. I posted this as my status, this thing that I experienced, just to see if I'd gone crazy or if everybody else in the world had grown stupid in the night. And, you know, nobody else, except for on this page, Practitioners of the Craft, that was it earlier, Practitioners of the Craft, was as stupid. Was as stupid as their admin that argued with me, called me rude, told me to stop trolling because I kept asking. I go, wait, no, really, I want to know. What am I missing here? The wax burns down before the wick. I don't know, even if you're burning one of those upside down candles, it tends to be always working. And I don't think she was doing that kind of reversing. That's a newer technique that we didn't see. Reversing candles didn't have to be upside down, you know, all the time. So at any rate, so I got kicked off of that page for trying to, you know, question the obvious. And listen, kids, everything out there doesn't have a mystical meaning. Sometimes a bird just shits on your window. It doesn't matter, you know, what kind of bird it was. It might not have been a message. It doesn't even matter if the bird shit looked like Jesus. It might not be an omen. It probably isn't. Don't be a fanatic. Shit happens. Candles burn like candles burn. No mystical meaning in that. Now, there's a couple pages that I'm extremely active on. I'm active kind of on the sassy witches. I don't think they let me post the show there, so I'm not going to talk too much about that. There's a couple other places that are almost the exact same name. And I was confused for a while myself. There's Beginners, Wicca, and Witchcraft. And Wicca and Witchcraft for Beginners. Who tend to seem to have a lot of the same people on there. And maybe even some of the same admins. I run into the same admins on several of these pages. So. But the first one, I think it's Beginners, Wicca, and Witchcraft. Has an extensive file section that's just, you know, a wealth of information for noob witches. Answering the vast majority of the questions that any noob witch could ever want to ask. And even when they join and they click on the thing where they're told, you know, see the file section, they don't. And they will ask a question that had they just scrolled along the page a little bit, they would have seen that question had been asked five times that day. You know, just the question, you know, how do I know my familiar? How do I know who my goddess is? Any suggestions for setting up my altar? And it's quite often an ER. And I try not to get upset. I try not to be a total dick. I try not to type before coffee. Sometimes it might slip. when you've answered the same question 10 times on a page in a day, it gets a little monotonous. And you got all the same people offering the same answers that they offered 10 times on that same question on that page. Why can't we make it read? Why won't kids read? Read. This is the first one. I think it's the first one's Beginners, Wicca, and Witchcraft. An impressive file section. I have dug the stuff that I've seen in their file section, and the majority of everything that is asked by a noob witch on the page is already answered in the file section. And several times in several posts on the page. See you on Pagan Gossip. Strick says, well, yes, Pagan Gossip lets me post this show. I have to say, you know, as a sometimes Pagan Gossip show host, that's why I went to Pagan Gossip. But I've been the only one that I've seen post any gossip on there. There was one thing one time, but I posted some tidbits on there. You know, stuff we were covering on Wittershins most of the time. Which is why I learned about the gossip. But I have not picked up much Pagan Gossip from Pagan Gossip page. But I like the page. Some fun people on there. And you can't be a snowflake. A lot of people are. The Chaos Magic group, CMG, they let me post there too. Like the Chaos Magic group. I'd like to see some more Chaos Magic and you know, less posts telling me when I cannot masturbate, but you know, that's your page, what else? mentioned before, Witches and Warlocks. Witches and Warlocks always been good. They always let me post my stuff. And we've picked up a lot of listeners from Witches and Warlocks. They have, you know, Pat Christian on the show, and several, a couple of the guests that we had on the show are people that he hooked me up with in the first place. So, of course. Witchcraft, Magic, and Esotericism. It's been around a long time. I've been on there. A little bit more admin chastising of late than they didn't used to have. And, you know, I don't mind that. But, you know, sometimes they're going to get mad. Well, who gives a fuck? A lot of times, somebody would all bent out of shape at me on one of these nude pages simply because I said something that they've never heard of. And then they will talk about how they learned everything from their high priestess. And they're going to go with what their high priestess said. They're going to throw all these names and titles that they have at me and why they, you know, disagree with me without ever actually having an argument why they have a disagree with me, except that, you know, they learned it from a high priestess and blah, 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 blah. And sometimes they get really pissed off, and sometimes their admins, they'll, like, mute me, or they'll block me from the page or something like that. You know, I got to say, the majority of the times that I run into this, you know, I go and I'll click on that person's picture that's just all so butthurt about the fact that I said something that they didn't know. And I'll look at them, and you know, 9 times out of 10, you know, you see somebody that has no personal power in their lives, no control over their lives, and quite often their hygiene. And somebody makes them an admin on one of these pages, and they become some ruthless dictator because it's the only place in the world, even the witchcraft world, where they can use their power. These two pages, the Beginner's Wicca and Witchcraft, and the Wicca and Witchcraft for Beginners, with a lot of the same people on there, you know, run into, there's some decent people on those pages. There's some teachers trying to teach some stuff. There's some noobs wanting not to listen to some stuff. There's a lot of people arguing when there's not really an argument at all. But there's people out there that are trying, and it gets frustrating, and they're butting their heads against the wall, and you know, I feel that every day. All right, I'm gonna play this. You know, for the admins and the experienced people on some of these pages that I'm speaking about, a song for you to help, you know, beat your head against the wall.
Take a chance on the wine. Your starch white hips, intravenous she drips, in fear of turning blind. Head of grey, some guys say, shows you growing old. Do it again, I can't explain. The light just seems so cold. Feel the pain. It leaves no stain. Feel the pain. The name of the game. Drops and blues, time to choose. Oh, why your heart is just a stabbing. Bloody eyes can't describe the nature of your hacking. Back to front, taste blunt in the safety of your bedroom. No desire to touch the fire. It's just a sad obsession. Feel the pain. It leaves no stain. Name of the game. Feel the pain. It leaves no stain. No stain. Feel the pain. The name of the game. Feel the pain. I feel the.
I gotta get through my list here, man. I got stuff I gotta plug and things. Brings me next to Ceremonial Magic School. Those people, you know, wanting to, you know, study the ceremonial side of things. They're doing it there. They're teaching each other and stuff. And somehow, your dear Uncle Birch is an admin there. I may have a lot of ceremonial magic in my witchcraft, but I don't have witchcraft and my ceremonial magic? I don't know. I don't know. But I'm not technically a ceremonialist, but I have found myself schooling ceremonialists on a couple of their rituals. That LBRP, man. The one thing that we use, I found myself over there schooling some of them. Yeah, they're talking about... Oh, wow. Well, they're talking about all kinds of stuff in the chat room. All right. I was just checking to see if anybody was listing any other sites. But so the Ceremonial Magic School, you got it. Now, I'm an admin there. And I have one main rule. If you apply for membership there, answer the fucking questions. I don't care if you answer Mickey Mouse. Matter of fact, do that. Answer Mickey Mouse. Just so I can see who this is. This shit. But if you don't answer anything, I all day long, I press decline, decline, decline. And if somebody answers, I don't even look at the answers. Just the fact that they read the thing and answered the questions, I approve them. Unless they live in Nigeria. And I'm sorry, that's Nigeria's fault. There's just more, there always was more scamming from Nigeria on the internet than anywhere else, but now in the spiritual communities, even more so, man. The fucking Babalawos. Did I even say it right? I never say it right. Babalawos. The Babalawos from Nigeria are out there scamming in the spiritual community all over the place. And the few that we let in there, sure enough, you know, just so I'm sorry. If I see Nigeria in there, I can't approve. I'm not being racist. I'm just, I guess, anti-Nigerian. Just Nigeria. Or anti-Nigeria. There's just too much scamming. And I don't accept friends from there. And if you got in your fucking name, I don't accept those. And besides, we're not supposed to get along with them anyways. I always heard that Poleros and Babalawao. Wow. They don't get along. She's rolling her eyes and face fisting. It's more than face palming. It's like face fisting. I can't even describe that. But anyway, Ceremonial Magic School. If you come across my feed, answer the questions. Don't be from Nigeria and you'll probably get a So, I got to be on YouTube Pagans, because I'm a YouTube Pagan. That's, you know, one of my, you know, where a lot of my colleagues are. So I'm on that page. There's another one. There's YouTube Pagan Communities, but that guy is just always such a butthurt little man. But YouTube Pagans has had less than that. But it's a cool page, and you can, you know, find, you know, more YouTube Pagan pages while you're on Facebook. Isn't that cool? Yeah, okay. Rue's Kitchen. Gotta like Rue's Kitchen. Rue, she gets into a lot of Strega and stuff in there, like Italian folk magic and stuff. Now that I'm speaking this, damn it, she wrote a book, and we needed to have her on. I thought somebody was going to reach out to her, but actually I know her, so I should just fucking do that. But I'm pretty sure Rue has a Italian folk magic book, and extremely remiss that we have not had her on yet. There's one called Pagan. It's just all block letters, you know, all caps, Pagan. And it's a huge page. There's a lot of people on this page. Seems rather international, seems kind of European. Followers of the old ways. Now, it tends to be an Ozatru, Germanic, Nordic, you know, that branch of the magical family trees. It always kind of irks me sometimes. It's like, you know, followers of the old ways. The old ways, when I grew up, as witchcraft. And certain branches have latched onto terms like that, and those have become like followers of the old ways. That's kind of like one of their little code words now for the Ozatru types and Nordic types. And also Celtic. They also have claimed Celtic now. I always thought it was, you know, I just said it, you know, Germanic, Nordic, you know, Ozatru types. Well, now they're Celtic. And they've claimed the Celtic brand, and, you know, Celtic was Irish. Celtic was Irish witchcraft when I was growing up, but maybe to distance themselves from the Germanic Nazi thing, I don't know. But that branch of the magical family tree has latched onto terms like Celtic, like heathen, you know, back in my day, heathen and pagan were used interchangeably. They meant pretty much the same thing. It either meant you were a hillbilly or a hick in the old tongue. Then probably my latest one that I've been on that I've been really enjoying, because there's not a whole lot of pages out there. Get Your Conjure On. Is it St. Elias? I'm thinking it's St. Elias' page. But Get Your Conjure On. He's at least on there. A lot of page, you know, it's all conjure, hoodoo, that kind of thing, southern varieties of magic, but a good group of people so far. Haven't really had a problem with anybody there. Yeah, Two Moons, I think it's Rue's Kitchen Witchery. Or wait, is that the book? I think that's the book. Yeah, I have not read the book yet, but I'm remiss. You know, it's a book on Italian folk magic, and I haven't read it. That's wrong. That's just wrong. And I should have had her on the show by now, and I need to fucking do that. I mean, her name's Rue. Like my favorite fucking plant, man. Yeah. Even Marta's going like this with her hands. Like, what? What? Why? What?
I'm just exactly. Thinking how cute.
She's just thinking about cute. Did you hear that? Yeah, sure. Let's see. Get Your Conjure On. And then, you know, there's a lot of people that I like live, but the people that have caught my most attention, Ifa Abeu, it's IFAABEYO, and Ambrosine Laguerre, and Kenya Koviak. Several other people, but these people tend to go live pretty often, and they have stuff to teach. And Kenya is often, like, you know, doing it with a glass of wine, which I'd like, it'd be like a to-go coffee cup full of wine. And so the show gets better as time goes on, but they'll go live, and I think those people all have fan pages. I don't think those are all just personal pages. I know Ambrosine Laguerre, Conjure, is open page, her public page. But she's Amber Zine. You know, when she jumps in there to fucking teach, man, it's gonna be some deep shit. It's not, you know, she didn't just hop on there to teach some silly ass fucking candle magic or something. Teach you how to use a pendulum. it's deep. It's deep shit. And Kenya's some deep shit too, but just funny as fuck most times. Eva's also pretty damn deep. But, you know, those are just some of the live ones I like. There are so many of them out there, but I gotta tell you about this other thing before I forget. Well, I wasn't gonna forget, but Hexfest coming, and you know, I'm presenting there, so I gotta talk about it, right? I gotta plug it, right? You gotta go to Hexfest. You gotta go to Hexfest and tell them that you're there just to see Uncle Birch. Now, whether they'll have me back next year, join in the magic. Tales of the magic of the Crescent City of New Orleans stretched back over the centuries. We just watched Coven all over again just because of that. Yeah. Thinking about New Orleans. Now we're going to watch Roanoke. Is that New Orleans? I don't know. Where's that? Where's Roanoke?
It's Roanoke.
Okay. Anyways, back to my plug. It's an enigmatic place where voodoo, hoodoo, witchcraft, and even Christianity blend at the crossroads of spiritual power. On August 9th to the 11th, 2019, Brian Kane, Christian Day, and the Witches of New Orleans present Hexfest, a weekend of witchery held in the heart of the historic French Quarter. The conference opens with a riverboat ritual and dinner held on an authentic steamboat on the Mississippi River, followed by two full days of workshops, drumming, and ritual at the Bourbon's Orleans Hotel, a venue riddled with a history of hauntings. Hexfest has gathered witches, root workers, voodoo priests, and other magical teachers from within New Orleans and around the world to offer their time-honored wisdom. Between workshops, attendees will love the magical shopping and our on-site vending hall, where you can purchase powerful ritual tools, signed books, exquisite jewelry and spellcrafts handmade by true practitioners. Presenters for the 2019 Hexfest hail from across the spectrum of witchcraft and magic and include Brian Kane, Christian Day, Austin Shippey, Byron Ballard, Cario Crow, Christine Steffens, Dorothy Morrison, the Dragon Ritual Drummers, Fiona Horn, Hoodoo Sen Moise, Lady Rhea, Laura Tempest Zaycroft, Michael Carell, Melissa Mayhem, Patricia Telesco, Rosemary Ellen Gilly, Sally Ann Glassman, Sandra Maria Wright, Sen Elias, Sorita Deste, Star Cassis, Star Ravenhawk, Witch Doctor Utu, and Yeshe Matthews. Whether you're a beginner or an advanced practitioner, Hexfest will help you discover the secrets of witchcraft and expand your mystery in the magical arts. Go to hexfest.com and register quickly. Tickets are going to sell out, I'm telling you, man. Oh, don't tell me, sadly, you won't make Hexfest, Strix. Get it together. Get it together and get there. We're going to be there. You got to be there. Candelo's going to be there. Candelo's going to be there. He's just coming to hang out. But rumor has it that he signed on for next Hexfest. I heard something like that. A little bird said something like that. We'll see if that pans out. But, you know, it's a gossip show, too, you know, this Wittershins thing. So I ain't want to gossip. You ain't heard that from me. See the look on Marta's face, the clown to the right of me. So those are some of my favorites, and the ones from the chat room in there. You know, if you know your shit, you know, get on there. Get on some of these, like the Beginner's Wicca and Witchcraft, Wicca and Witchcraft for Beginners. You know, try not to be a dick. I try not to be a dick, but sometimes they just push me. They just push me. But I have a whole lifetime of witchcraft behind me and a long memory. And I've worked hard to eradicate my short-term memory. My long-term memory's long. I don't remember a lot of shit. And there were standards that all witchcraft and Wicca had. There were standards that we all knew. There were standard practices that all covens, all traditions, all variations of all witchcraft knew. Some of these were things based all the way back in Hermetics. And that's from Africa, too. I'll have you know. And those things I have seen fading from the landscape of witchcraft, Wicca, all of the magics, ancient knowledge that all of our ancestors passed on to all of us, lost in all of the different traditions. Some traditions because they're trying to stay an oral tradition, this happens. Some traditions because we have stuff like this, where people repeat random shit that they heard on the internet as if they were some sort of authority figure rather than just sitting the fuck down and shutting the fuck up. Stuff like, all that matters is your intention. Do whatever you feel is right. Whatever you feel is right. These kinds of things are rampant. Magic follows rules. The rules of nature. Nature cares not for your fucking intent. Your intent's important. Your intent's a power force. The rules of magic are simple and finite. Any Cosmo girl would know. Is it Cosmo, like, you know, the cosmos. Any Cosmos girl would know. But there are rules of nature that all of our ancestors and all of the various traditions once knew. And in all of the traditions I've come to be fortunate enough to study, these are being lost. I see these being lost even in Palo. I see these being lost in Hoodoo. I see these being lost in Conjure. There's ancient constants that all of our ancestors knew that are being lost by the fast times we live in and by people that want to be an authority figure before it is time. There may be time for you to teach others, but get enough shit in your bag of tricks before you strike out there in the world and do so. And when you come up against somebody that has those things in their bag of tricks, don't become all butthurt. That will not sway the argument, at least with me. You better have a good fucking argument, because I come from a very old school of witchcraft, and Mom taught me that a witch knows why it works. Now, she had different views on folk magic. She said, folk magicians know what works. A witch knows why it works. Why, how, when, and where it works. The backwards, the forwards, the ins and the outs. The weave and the unweave. A witch knows all of it. A witch knows the entire pattern involved with the magic that we're discussing. That's how I grew up. It's not for the meek and the mild. It may be hardcore. Some of your elders may have to get up in your face and scare you a little bit to teach you something. But that's old school. That's how it was done. Most of you wouldn't have survived what your ancestors went through to learn what you pick up on a fucking Facebook page. Yes, the instant gratification. I've known too many of even our own kids that fluttered from one magic to the other without spending enough time in any of those magics to learn anything worthwhile. I absolutely advocate, you know, learning different types of magic, but learn them. Learn them from beginning to end, if there is such a thing, and then learn something else. Add it to your magic if you want. But learn the shit. Learn the shit inside and out, especially if you're going to teach it to others. Because I have watched too much magic, too much magical principles, too many important things that new witches should know die out. And if it wasn't for people like me, they would die out. I find myself repeating things that nobody says anymore. I find now on some of these noob sites. I just heard something today. Somebody today post to somebody, you know, nature abhors a vacuum. When you cleanse, you've got to put something back in that space. Now, I know she knew that, but the words that she used were my words. That's all I need. You know, that makes my heart feel good. I don't need anybody to say, I learned that from Uncle Birch, or Uncle Birch taught me that. The fact that I hear those extremely important words that just 2 years ago I heard nobody speaking of in the entire magical landscape, a magical constant, a law of nature, a law of physics that all witches once knew. Nobody was saying that. And I said it and 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 said it. I'm like fucking Trump with that, man. I just kept fucking repeating it till it became the narrative. And I've seen that become the narrative in many places. And I hope that my tenacity had some sort of influence on that. So that's one of the reasons. In addition to keeping my teaching muscles strong, that's why I recommend people do that. You know, if you know your shit, get on these noob sites, man. Don't let kindergartners teach kindergartners witchcraft. That's how we got here. That's how we got so much fucked up shit. That's how nobody knows what's fucking going on anymore, and fucking half of witchcraft can't put together a fucking candle spell. Too much bullshit. Too many people repeating bullshit. Too many people not calling people on the fucking bullshit, and gone the way of the copy editor in witchcraft, man. And I will not let that happen on my watch. And it may cause me endless frustration, but I'm gonna keep doing that. And they're probably gonna ask me to be an admin one of these days on one of these new pages because I'm so fucking up in there. But I'll probably do it. I started that for one thing, and now I'm keeping it up for other reasons. There's just certain things I'm not going to let die out on my fucking watch. I'm not going to let witches that haven't studied anything teach other witches, even though I started teaching witchcraft a week into my witchcraft 101 course. But I am not them. I had a certain skill that apparently was present even way back then, and I ended up being rushed into the teacher program because apparently I had a skill. I was a teacher, and I was teaching. I'm not recommending that to anybody. Nobody should follow my life's example. Don't drop out of high school to study witchcraft full-time. Don't expect to make your fucking living being a witch. It doesn't.
Stay in fucking school, kids.
Stay in witch school, too, kids. All right, we got to get out of here. And pretty damn quick here. We have anything more to say? I'm sorry. You could jump in anytime. You know you cut me off anytime, and you're very good at it.
Yes.
Yes.
But you were like on your own little personal tangent, so I was gonna let you have that.
I saw her fall in love with me in witch school while I was on one of those tangents. There's a certain spark that happens. She didn't know. We developed a relationship before she knew that I was the one teaching the class that she had signed up for. So I think it was kind of within the rules that they had. You know, teachers can't sleep with students and that kind of thing. We didn't sleep together for quite a while. But I remember the moment it happened. She likes when I rant about witchcraft like that. She likes it. Yeah. So that's why she's been over there quiet.
It's cute. Just
talking about my pretty mouth and stuff. Oh, dear. Way too much TMI for you fucking people. Good thing, you know, most of you are regulars. Who knows? Wait.
What?
Oh, people that are in the chat room are messaging me, too.
All right.
You have been tuned to Witterson's Radio. You can find us at wittershinsradio@gmail.com. You can find us at wittershinsradio on Facebook. You can find us at spreaker.com/users/wittershins. iHeartRadio, I don't know what the address is there. You know, Tumblr. Eventually I'll get around to putting us up on iTunes, or somebody will teach me how to have those things automatically upload, like on every other leg of this project. The shows just automatically upload. I don't have to think about it. That's why I don't remember some of the places that we're broadcasting. But I can't go through all the trouble of doing not iHeartRadio, iTunes, that kind of thing. It was too stupid not to share. Oh dear. But yeah, so I absolutely recommend, you know, if you don't know your shit, you know, you can learn a lot of stuff by seeing what a lot of these other people ask. And seeing the answers, you just sit back there and eat popcorn and stuff. But even like, get your conjure on. There's a lot of, you know, new conjure people or new hoodoo people on there asking questions. If you know that kind of stuff, you know, I've definitely done my hoodoo study, and in that I found out that a lot of the witchcraft I was raised on was hoodoo. You know, there's mom had a huge bag of tricks. There was hoodoo, there was conjure, there was ceremonial magic, there was even some elements of chaos magic, high magic, ceremonial magic. Mom had a big bag of tricks, and it turned out she was very studied in hoodoo. And we came and we moved here to Hollywood, and we met a friend on the internet that I know that turned out to be a friend of mine's god kid, Apollo. And that was small world, right? Moved to Hollywood, right? Met this guy all the way over there. And I finally actually meet him in person. We get to talking. And this woman that I'm talking about right now, my mom, I called her mom. She was my witch mother. She raised me, you know, in the craft as much as my mother raised me in the world. Is his grandmother. Is his actual birth grandmother. We had a serious fucking small world moment. So I know one person that can talk about their like hoodoo grandmother, although she, you know, she didn't use the words hoodoo. It wasn't a popular word back then. We didn't know as much as we know now about what is hoodoo, what is conjure, what is this, what is that. Back then, those things were all just a big pile of witchcraft. There were a lot of South American magics that I was practicing as a kid too. Those were just witchcraft back in the day, and now we just kind of know more. So I do teach those kind of things too. But you know, by all means, get out there, man. Don't let it all just fade away by letting kids teach other kids what they don't know. There's too much lost out there. There's been too much lost just in my short, you know, 40 odd years in the craft. Standards that we all had, that we all knew, that were important, made the magic work, lost in all traditions. So get involved, get out there. I'll see you over there in the Beginners Wicca and Witchcraft, and Wicca and Witchcraft for Beginners, and Pagan Gossip, Chaos Magic, and Witchcraft Warlocks,
and Monster. Like,
oh my god, you scared the hell out of me with that.
What?
You scared me.
Oh, sorry.
All right. Wittershins. You find us next Tuesday, 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Thank you.
Take it. says I'm looking for one thing real tonight. And I'm up here singing these songs every night. Sometimes I wanna just make them all. Chosen me. Let's turn off the commercials. Let's turn off the TV. How well can we get to know each other in an hour? We can fight the daylight. We have that power. With a bucket full of paste, he rips off my ear and says, glue this to my face. I'd like to leave America for some place where they would not know a word of English, and I might be understood.